Hey everyone, and welcome back to the channel. In this video, we'll be learning how to calculate the equilibrium price and quantity when both the demand and supply equations involve fractions. With that said, let's get into it. So sometimes you'll have demand and supply equations which have fractions instead of nice round integers to use. And in this case, it can sometimes make the algebra more tricky. We want this video to be dedicated specifically to learning how to calculate market equilibrium algebraically, but using supply and demand equations which involve fractions, because it's quite common for you to be receiving questions like this on a test or a homework assignment. So in front of us, we have a demand equation QD, or quantity demanded, is equal to 20 minus 5 over 3p. The supply equation is denoted QS, or quantity supplied, is equal to negative 5 plus 5 over 2p. And you'll notice in the first equation, the demand equation, there's a negative coefficient on p, and that makes sense because quantity demanded and price are negatively related as per the law of demand. And on the second equation, the supply equation, you'll notice that there is a positive coefficient on price, and that also makes sense because there is a positive relationship between price and quantity when you're talking about supply. The most important part to remember is that in equilibrium, quantity demanded is equal to quantity supplied. This is the point where the two curves, the supply curve and the demand curve, cross over one another on a graph. But we don't want to do any graphing. We just want to do this calculation algebraically. However, the most important and first step is to set these two equations equal to one another. So let's do that. So if QD is equal to 20 minus 5 over 3p, and QS is equal to negative 5 plus 5 over 2p, then I can sub these in on their respective sides of the equal sign. Now in this case, I have quantity demanded in blue and quantity supplied in red, just so that you can see that all I did was sub in the two equations on each side of the equal sign. I'm going to get rid of the colors in a second, don't worry. So I went from having two different equations, one for quantity demanded and one for quantity supplied, to having just one equation with one unknown. This is going to enable me to solve for the equilibrium price, which is P in this equation, where the two quantities are set to equal one another. So I'm going to rearrange this equation to have all of the P's on one side and all of the constants on the other. In this next line, I move the negative 5 from the right side to the left, and upon doing so, it becomes a positive 5. And then to collect like terms, I move the negative 5 over 3p to the right side. You'll notice it also switched signs, so it is now positive 5 over 3p. Now all of my p's are on one side and all of my constants are on the other. However, here's where it gets tricky with fractions. You'll notice I can't actually add the two p values because they have different denominators. So this is where a lot of students mess up. I can't simply add the numerators and add the denominators because that's not how you add fractions. So I need these coefficients to have the same denominator. And I'm looking for the lowest common denominator, which is the lowest number that both 2 and 3 go into. And that number is 6. So I need to rewrite these two fractions, but with denominators of 6 so that I can actually add them together. And I have 5 over 2, is rewritten as 15 over 6, and 5 over 3 is rewritten as 10 over 6. These are equivalent fractions. That is, they're quite literally the exact same fraction. Let me remind you how to do this though. So I wanted to pick 6 as the common denominator because it's a number that both 2 and 3 go into. I could have picked any number, I just chose the lowest number that they both went into, but I could have chosen 12 or 18 or 24 or any other number that they both go into, and this still would have worked. However, it is typically best practice to use the smallest or the lowest common denominator. So what did I do to 2 to get to 6? Well, I multiplied it by 3. However, to avoid changing the value of the fraction, I would then need to multiply the top number by 3 as well. And that's how 5 times 3 is 15, and 2 times 3 is 6. Similarly, to get 5 thirds into 10 sixths, I multiply the denominator by 2, 3 times 2 is 6, and therefore I must multiply the numerator by 2 as well, 5 times 2 is 10. So these fractions are the exact same fractions, they're just 3 times greater. If 15 over 6 and 10 over 6 were reduced, they would go back to 5 over 2 and 5 over 3. However, I need them to be the same denominator if I want to add them together. So I'm going to rewrite the previous line, but this time it's going to have the denominators as 6. So I've added 20 plus 5, and that gives me 25. Now I have 15 over 6p plus 10 over 6p. And again, this is just the exact same fractions that we had before, except both denominators are the same, which now lets me add the numerators. So the next line is simple. I just add the numerators on the fractional coefficients on the p-values. So 25 is equal to 15 plus 10 over 6, which is just 25 over 6p. Again, I did this just by adding 15 plus 10, and because they're over the same denominator of 6, I'm allowed to do this. This is the second trickiest part where people make a lot of mistakes with fractions. I'm trying to isolate p, which means I need to divide both sides of the equal sign by 25 over 6. 25 over 1, which is just 25, divided by 25 over 6 is equal to p. This is what happens when I divide both sides by 25 over 6. The p-value is now isolated because 25 over 6 divided by 25 over 6 is just 1, and I'm left with the left side looking a little bit more confusing than I'd like. But don't worry, I'll remind you how to divide fractions very briefly, that way you can solve this on your own. So 25 divided by 25 over 6 can be rewritten as a multiplication problem if I flip or write the reciprocal of the second fraction. Let me show you what I mean. So 25 over 1 divided by 25 over 6 can be rewritten as 25 over 1 times 6 over 25. So 6 over 25 is just the reciprocal or the fraction flipped over. Well, now it's easy because for multiplication, I just multiply numerator times numerator and denominator times denominator. This yields the following line. 25 times 6 is 150 and 1 times 25 is 25. So my next line is 150 divided by 25 equals p. And then finally, I can just do that division on the left side to get a value of 6 is equal to p. Or if you're like me and you like the numbers on the right and the letters on the left, p equals 6. That right there is my equilibrium price. I'm going to leave this on the screen for just a second so that you have an opportunity to write it down and to check over these steps. If there's any part that you found confusing, then please feel free to leave a comment in the comment section and I can probably explain it more specifically. So now I have my p equals 6 value, but what do I do with the equilibrium p value? Because the point of equilibrium is both a p value and a q value. So I need to take this p value, I need to sub it back into the demand or supply equation. And so you might be wondering, well, which equation do I sub the 6 into? And to be honest, it doesn't matter because at equilibrium, QD is equal to QS. And what this means is that no matter which equation you sub in P equals 6, if the equilibrium price is 6, then it should give you the same answer for Q no matter which equation you sub it into. And just to show you that that's the case, I'm going to sub it into both equations and they should give you the same Q value. If they don't, then you know that you've made an algebraic mistake. So let's start by subbing in p equals 6 into the demand equation and solving for q. So let me rewrite the equation. Qd is equal to 20 minus 5 over 3p. But I know what p is, so I'm going to sub it in. Qd is equal to 20 minus 5 over 3 times 6. Remember, anytime that you're multiplying an integer by a fraction, you simply multiply the integer by the numerator because there is an invisible denominator of 1 under that 6. So the next line should look like Qd is equal to 20 minus 30 over 3. And the 30 is just 6 times 5, and the denominator is still 3. And I can actually do that division on the right side to yield the next line, which is QD is equal to 20 minus 10. And 10 is simply 30 divided by 3. And then finally, with some simple subtraction, QD is equal to 10. So I'm going to note this on the side because I told you that if you were to sub in P equals 6 into the supply equation, you would get the exact same value for Q. So let's make sure. Rewriting the supply equation gives me QS is equal to negative 5 plus 5 over 2P. I'm going to sub in 6 for P because I know what it is in equilibrium. That gives me QS is equal to negative 5 plus 5 over 2 times 6. Once again, I'm going to simply multiply that 6 times 5 to get me 30, And the next line is QS is equal to negative 5 plus 30 over 2. Well, I can do the division. 30 divided by 2 is simply 15. And my next line is QS is equal to negative 5 plus 15. And then finally, with some simple addition, QS is equal to 10. And what do you know? The QS and the QD values are the exact same. And this has to happen. And it will only happen at one point, and that is equilibrium. If I subbed in a p-value for anything except 6, my quantity demanded and quantity supplied would not be the same. And this is just because these are both linear equations and they only have one point of intersection. So now I can denote that QD is equal to QS, which is equal to 10. And this means that my quantity at equilibrium is equal to 10. So now I have my two values, P is equal to 6 and Q is equal to 10. Those are my two equilibrium values. However, it's worth denoting these in proper form. So P is equal to 6, Q is equal to 10, Q comma P is equal to 10 comma 6. That's just a coordinate on a Cartesian plane where these two linear equations intersect. So if I were to actually draw out the demand curve and draw out the supply curve, this is the point on that graph where the Q and the P values are the same. As you may know, this point is known as market equilibrium. And one final thing worth noting is you want to denote P and Q as equilibrium points, because right now they could denote any P or Q combination. So typically what I would teach my students to do, and I would encourage you to do as well, is to denote them with a star or an asterisk. So P star is equal to 6, Q star is equal to 10, and therefore the coordinate Q star comma P star is equal to 10 comma 6. And all that does is denote for you that you're looking at equilibrium values rather than simply any other coordinate that you may have on your supply and demand graph. Once again, we have another video if you want additional practice on the channel that does not involve any fractions. Feel free to go over that if you find that you want additional practice. But if you found yourself struggling to calculate equilibrium because there were fractions in the equations, then I really hope that this video helped you out. If you enjoyed the video, let us know by liking the video, subscribing to the channel, and of course, let us know in the comments section what sort of economic topics or homework questions you'd like to see us cover in the future. Thanks for watching this video, and we'll catch you in the next.